Yeah. You ready? Hey. Let's go. Bet.
Wow. How are we doing tonight, guys? Doing good? How many of you guys are on spring break right now? Wow. We got some seasoned saints up in the house, y'all. You guys are here on spring break. Good for y'all. Good for y'all. Well, hey, tonight we are going to be, the title of my sermon is Turn the World Upside Down. Turn the World Upside Down. And pertaining to the title, the theme of our spring retreat that we got coming up, which is Out of the Darkness. Tonight we're going to be talking about Paul and Silas out of Acts chapter 17. So this is where I got the title for tonight's message. It says in verse 6, it says, "These men who have turned the world upside down have come here also." How many of you guys think it'd be pretty cool that, like, you go to a new place, a place you've never been before? Say you just, like, got in your car and you drove to, I don't know, what, you drove to Guatemala. Never been to Guatemala before. And they're like, "Where are you from?" And you're like, "Oh, you know, Edwardsville or Alton or Highland or whatever. You know, I go to New Hope Youth." They're like, "New Hope Youth? You're one of the ones who's turning the world upside down. That's pretty crazy, right?" That's how Paul and Silas are addressed. And, you know, one of the things that should define a Christian, one of the things that every Christian should do, is that you should make a difference. Period. If you're a Christian, you should be making a difference. Out of the darkness of our culture, your light should shine bright. Because God has empowered us with the Holy Spirit. God lives in us. God equips us. God goes with us. God does amazing things through us in our life, in the lives of the people that we meet. And the reality is, I mean, there's a lot of Christians who do this. There's a lot of you guys in here who do this. You guys, when you go somewhere, you guys make an impact. You guys make an impact on your school. You guys make an impact in your family. You guys make an impact on your sports team. You guys make an impact. There's a lot of you guys that do that. But at the same time, there's a lot of Christians who don't do this. You live your life, and you don't do jack squat for the kingdom. In fact, if you were to ask most people at your school, they won't even know that you're a Christian. And here's what's extraordinary about this statement that was made about Paul and Silas, is that Paul and Silas, they had just arrived in Thessalonica. Say Thessalonica. And Thessalonica is 100 miles from the city of Philippi, which is where Paul and Silas were just coming from. Now, 100 miles in the days before trains and planes and automobiles and, I mean, even bicycles, 100 miles is a long ways. And in just 3 weeks' time, they're already talking about how Paul and Silas had turned the world upside down. That's a pretty crazy statement, that word traveled that fast. You know, and when people who aren't Christians are recognizing that you're turning the world upside down, that's an amazing thing, right? Now, what I wanna communicate to you guys tonight, what I want you guys to get through your heads and walk away here with, is that God wants to turn the world upside down through you. Every single one of you. There's no one in here who's exempt from that. God wants to turn the world upside down through you. God wants, out of the darkness of this current time, out of the darkness of this culture, if you guys just turn on the news, you'll know what I'm talking about. You scroll through social media. God wants us to be a people who make an impact in our family, who make an impact in our school, who make an impact with our friend group. God wants to do mighty and powerful things through us. Whenever we're around people, whenever we're in a place, we should leave that place different than we found it. Listen, you guys should leave your middle school, you guys should leave your high school different than you found it. When you guys graduate high school, your friend group should be acting differently than it was when you became friends with those people. You guys need to leave an impact. So the question is, how do we do that? You're like, "Okay, cool, rah, rah. How do we do that?" Well, Acts chapter 17, Paul, he teaches us exactly how to do that. So in Acts 17, Paul and Silas are going to visit three cities. They're going to visit Thessalonica, Berea, say Berea, and Athens. You guys have probably heard of that. Athens, it's in Greece. And they're going to make a massive impact in each of those places. And they do it by implementing what I would call the five principles to help us make a difference. And the first one on your guys' cards, if you're taking notes, is don't be afraid to share the gospel with others. Don't be afraid to share the gospel with others. Now, if we're being honest out here, a lot of people never get past this point. I know I said that there's five principles, but the vast majority of Christians, if we're just being real, never get past this point because they're afraid, right? Can I get any real people in here? Because it's scary sometimes, right? They get afraid of what people may think. They get afraid of what people may do. They get afraid of what people may say about them. They get afraid of what people or how people may respond. And honestly, if anyone could have been afraid, it would have been Paul and Silas, because if you read in the chapters before this, when they were in Philippi, which is the place where they just came from, they were beaten, they were flogged, they were put in prison. So if anyone has the right to be afraid about sharing the gospel, it probably would be Paul and Silas, right? I mean, they just got beat up, brutally tortured and thrown in prison. So if anyone has the right to be afraid, it's them. You know, it would have been really easy for them to say, you know what? I'm just going to play it safe. You know what? I'm going to stay back. I'm going to heal my wounds a little bit. You know what? Maybe I'll go to a different city. Maybe I'll go somewhere I've already been. This is what Christians love to think. Someone else will do it. You know, that's somebody else's calling. I know God put that on my heart, but I'm sure someone else will do it. It would have been really easy for them to say that, but they didn't. They overcame their fears. And some of you guys may be thinking, I know because I thought this, like, oh, well, Paul just wasn't afraid of anything. Paul had that dog in him, you know, if you guys know what I'm talking about. Paul had that dog, that D-A-W-G in him, you know. He wasn't afraid of nothing. Nothing got to him, you know. He was just built different. But that's not true, you know. If you look at Acts chapter 18, this is what it says. And honestly, this is kind of the viewpoint that you can have if you just read the Bible at a surface level, or maybe you only read the Bible on Wednesday nights when it's up on the screen. But if we actually look at Acts chapter 18, this is what it says. It says, Crispus, the synagogue leader, and his entire household believed in the Lord, and many of the Corinthians who heard Paul believed and were baptized. One night, the Lord spoke to Paul in a vision. Do not be afraid. Keep on speaking. Do not be silent, for I am with you. And if you guys see, all throughout the New Testament, God is constantly reassuring Paul, don't be afraid, don't be afraid, don't be afraid. Now, God wouldn't constantly be saying that if Paul wasn't afraid, right? So clearly, Paul was afraid too, but the only thing is Paul didn't let that keep him from walking in God's will for him. And the reality is the word that was spoken over Paul in Acts chapter 18, that's what God's speaking over every single one of your lives tonight. He's saying, don't be afraid. You don't have to worry because I am with you. I'm going to go with you into your school. I'm with you when you're at home with your family. I'm with you when you're every single way or every single place that you go. You know, and maybe you're sitting there and you're intimidated. You're like, man, I'm afraid of what someone may say about me at school. Or I'm afraid of what this person might do to me. Or, you know, my family, they seem so disinterested. You know, they seem hostile. They seem like they could care less about it. But the words that Jesus spoke to Paul are the same words that he's speaking to you. And if you believe it in your heart, God will go with you. God will be with you everywhere that you go. And he'll give you the courage to talk about the gospel. You know, sometimes I think it's good to be afraid. In fact, I think it's always good to be a little bit afraid, because what that does is it causes you to rely on and it causes you to lean on God in a way that you wouldn't otherwise. You know, I would venture to say, if you ever feel like there's something that God put on your heart and you're like, oh yeah, I can do that, that's no problem, it's probably not from God, because God will never call you to something that makes him unnecessary, right? So actually, I think it's a good thing if you feel like God's put something on your spirit and you're sitting there thinking, man, I'm inadequate, I can't do this, I'm not up for that task, that's scary. That's a good thing, because that's going to cause you to rely on God and spend more time in prayer. And the reality is, when you call on the name of the Lord and you ask for Jesus to be with you when you're doing something that's for his kingdom, he will be with you every single time. Don't believe me? Try it. God will be with you always. He's going to help you. Number two, the second thing that Paul shows us, Start a conversation with people. Start a conversation with people. So if you want to lead people into a relationship with Jesus, you got to talk to people. You know, you guys have probably heard it said, you know, preach the gospel always, say words when necessary. You guys have ever heard that? Yeah, you guys ever heard that? Okay, well, maybe it's just a Bible school thing, Logan. Preach the gospel always, use words when necessary. It's like a stupid Pinterest thing. I think that's so dumb. It's so dumb. That is so anti-biblical. I disagree completely with that because you have to preach the gospel. To preach the gospel, you got to talk. To talk, you got to use words. Words make a difference. Words carry the weight of the Spirit. You know, I get the idea of living a godly life, and I think every single one of us with our life and with our actions shouldn't undo the words that we're speaking, but we shouldn't be silent. We can't just not share our faith. We can't just not talk about the gospel, you know, and just say, you know, I'm just going to live my life and let that be my witness, you know, just by the way that I smile at people and am nice. Yes, that's great. And I think it's great you should live like a Christian. But the reality is, like, you've got to talk. You've got to proclaim the gospel. Jesus said, go and preach the gospel to all living creatures. That means you got to speak. You got to open your mouth. You got to have a conversation with people. Listen, your religion is not a private and personal thing. That's a lie from the depths of hell. That's something that the enemy's putting in your head. Like, yeah, your faith, as long as you and God are good, that's all that matters. No, go and read the New Testament again. Your faith is never just about you and God. It's always about other people. That's a lie from the enemy to keep you from sharing your faith. It's ridiculous. Whenever I hear people say that, I'm like, show me the New Testament where it says that. You can't find it anywhere. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 2, it says, you yourselves are our letter, written on our hearts, known and read by everyone. Meaning that people, they see how you live. They hear what you say. It's as you and I speak. It's as you and I pray. It's as you and I live our lives and share our faith, share the gospel and encourage other people that we break the chains of darkness. But guys, we got to have a conversation. We got to have a conversation. We see in Acts chapter 17, verse 1, this is what it says. It says, when Paul and his companions had passed through Amphipolis, say Amphipolis, Amphipolis and Apollonia, say Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica. You guys can say that one too. Simon didn't say, but where there was a Jewish synagogue. Now, I've got a map, if we can throw that up. So for those of you guys that don't know, this is just going to kind of explain what's going on. So Paul, he started over here. He started off in Antioch, and then he went over to Derbe, and then he went up to Lystra. If you guys remember, that's where he picked up Timothy. Then he went to Iconium, and then he traveled all the way. I just kicked a fog machine. Then he traveled all the way over to Troas, and Troas is, that was about a 100-day journey all the way across there. And then, if you guys remember, that's where Paul got the vision, where there's a man from Macedonia, and he's like, please come help me. So he traveled over to Macedonia, and then he went to Philippi, and Amphipolis, and Apollonia, and Thessalonica, and Berea, and Athens. And that's where we're picking up. And here's what they do when they go into the synagogue. Moving on, in verse 2, it says, as was his custom, Paul went into the synagogue, and on three Sabbath days, he reasoned with them from the scriptures. Now, I want to highlight the word reasoned here. The word reasoned here is where we get our word dialogue, meaning that it wasn't just a one-way conversation. It wasn't Paul just walking into the synagogue and just shouting people down like those dingleberries you see standing on the street corner with the signs and microphones. It means it was a dialogue, all right? It was a two-way conversation. It means Paul was explaining things to them and he was listening back. It was a conversation that was taking place. And then moving on into verse 10, it says, as soon as it was night, the believers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. And then we see again in verse 16, it says, while Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue. We see it again with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. So what I want you guys to notice from this is Paul was not just in the synagogue speaking to Jews. He was also in the marketplace speaking to Gentiles. And it said he was doing it day and night, meaning that Paul wasn't discriminating who he was sharing his faith with. It didn't matter where he was. It didn't matter what time of day it was. Paul was sharing his faith. It was whoever crossed his path he was sharing the gospel with. Now, I don't know if you've ever thought about this, but too many times what happens is we treat sharing the gospel almost like we're like a loan officer. I mean, I know not a ton of people in here have ever bought a house before, but you guys probably know what I'm talking about, where it's almost like you're like interviewing them and it's like a checklist. And you're like, hmm. You're like, do they look nice? You're like, no. Check. Next. I'm not gonna share the gospel with them. You know, and then the next person comes on, you're like, do they look nice? You're like, yeah. You're like, they look nice. Like, do they look disinterested? Yeah, I don't think they really care. Check. No, I'm not gonna share it with them. And you keep on discounting all these people, you know, or it's like, you know, do I think they'd get angry? You know, do they look desperate? Do I think that they really could do this? And we give all these checklists and we try and like pre-qualify people for whether or not we're gonna share the gospel with them. Like somehow we're gonna be able to tell from their outward appearance whether or not they deserve salvation or not. You know, and I'm guilty of this too, but the problem with this is that we see things on the outside, God sees the inside, right? Man looks at the outward appearance, God looks at the heart. The problem is you and I, we don't know what's going on in their life. The thing is, when you look at someone, when you don't know someone, you don't know what God's been doing inside of them. You don't know how God has been stirring their heart. You know, they may look cold and calloused on the outside, but on the inside, they're desperate for hope. They're desperate for freedom. You know, they've been struggling with something for so long, they're just desperate to know that there's something more in this life. You can't read people's thoughts, and they may not look interested at all, but the reality is they may be ready to make a decision to follow Christ. That's why you and I, we can't judge by the exterior. We can't let people's facades that they put on. We can't, you know, just look at the Instagram or the Visco post, you know, where everything in their life looks perfect. We can't let that determine whether or not we're gonna share our faith with them. We just have to be willing. We just have to say, you know what? If God puts someone on my heart, if I feel like God's stirring something inside of me to go and speak to that person, if I feel like God's telling me to go and encourage that person, if I feel like God's telling me to go and share what God has done in my life with that person, then I'm just gonna step out in faith and I'm gonna do it, because even though it may be scary, even though I may be afraid, I believe that God's gonna be with me when I go and do that, and he's gonna give me the words to speak, and he's gonna empower me when I do that. So it says Paul's in the marketplace and he's sharing the gospel with all these different kinds of people. And I just want to challenge you, if God brings somebody in your path, if you feel like they're, and you'll know what I'm talking about, you know, when you have the Holy Spirit living inside of you, sometimes you'll just feel like that pressing on your heart, like, hey, you need to go and do this, or you need to pray for that person. I just want to challenge you, if you feel that, listen, I know it's easier said than done, go and do it and watch what God will do. Like it is, and I'm telling you, once you've done it, you will never regret it, and it's almost contagious. Like, the more you do it, like, the more you want to do it. You know, I can't even tell you how many times it's been like where I feel like God's telling me to go and pray for someone, and I'm like, I don't want to, you know. You start doing the little checklist, like you're doing pre-approved, and I'm like, I don't know. They don't look like they want to be talked to right now. But then you go and you pray for them, and you know, God gives you the words to speak, and it's just right, and you're like, man, I'm so glad that I did that. But I just want to challenge you, even when you're out in public, even if you don't have time to have an in-depth conversation with someone, at the very least, invite them to church. You never know what they may say. Let's just say, by a show of hands, who here in this room is here because someone invited you at some point? That's a lot of hands. Are you glad that someone invited you to New Hope Youth? I mean, are you glad that someone did that at some point? Okay, then... Now, what do you got to worry about? I mean, it's that simple. Just invite them to church. The worst thing they could say is no. I mean, Kirsten and I, we've been donating plasma for like 4 months or something. Basically just like fun money. Like I built like a desk and cool crap. But there's this lady at the plasma place, and her name is Jamie. And Kirsten and I have kind of gotten the chance to build a relationship with her. Kirsten more so than me, because Kirsten, I mean, she can become friends with a wall. I mean, she's just great. She's so good at talking to people, and she's so fun and bubbly, and she's just the best. And there's this lady named Jamie who works there, and I mean, just good old Kirsten. I mean, she invited her to church, and it was so cool. Like, I wasn't there. Like, there was no one there with Kirsten holding her hand to walk her through it. But I actually found out, not even from Kirsten telling me, Jamie told me. The next time that I saw Jamie, she's like, hey, I met your wife. I'm like, oh, cool. What'd she say? You know, I didn't know because I was like, if she's like explicitly saying, I met your wife, like there's going to be an interesting story. I'm like, oh no, what'd she say? She's like, yeah, she's the best. She invited me to church. And I'm like, proud husband moment, you know? Like, it's so cool. I mean, when I was in, and I was just thinking back, like when I was in middle school, I used to invite people to church with me all the time. Like after football practice or after wrestling practice, I would have between 5 and 10 of my buddies just come over to my house after practice and we'd just walk to the church together. You know, and honestly, the more people that started coming to Pastor Logan and I's youth group growing up, it was almost like contagious. Like it was like a snowball effect. And some of you guys in this room who have invited your friends, you know what I'm talking about. Like the more of your friends that start coming, the easier it is for more and more people to start coming. And a lot of those kids that I was friends with in middle school that I invited, you know, that just came over to my house and we went to church together, it was a super simple invite. They're still living for God and they're on fire for God now, you know, 10, 15 years later. And it's awesome. And I'm not saying that's like, make myself sound good, but I'm just saying, like, if I never invited them, I mean, who knows where they'd be right now? Who knows what their life may look like? It's simple, just to invite someone. You never know the power of a simple invite. The third point I want you guys to know is give people the gospel. Give people the gospel, plain and simple. Maybe you're like, what does that mean? Like, I've heard you say that. I've heard other people say that. What do you mean, give them the gospel? It's simple, guys. Tell them about Jesus. Tell them who he is. Tell them what he does. Tell them what he's done in your life. We see in verse 2 and 3, it says, and he reasoned with them from the scriptures, explaining and providing that Christ had to suffer and rise from the dead. This Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Christ, he said. Let me just encourage you guys with something. Listen, the power of the gospel is not dependent on your ability to give an articulate explanation of every single question that someone may have. The power of the gospel is simply in the message. That's where the power of the gospel is from. The power, our job is simply just to give them the good news. Listen, all it is God so loved the world, God so loved me, God so loved you that he sent his one and only son to live a perfect life, to die on a cross for your sins. He got raised from the dead. All you have to do is have faith in him and declare with your mouth that he is Lord and you'll have everlasting life. It's that simple. That is declaring the gospel. It's the simple gospel. It's amazing. And then what you have to do is you just have to start telling them about what God has done in your life. You know, and that's what witnessing really is. And what does a witness do? Shares things from their perspective, right? That's what a witness is. So when you're witnessing to someone, you're just telling them your side of the story. You're telling them what God has done for you, because that's the thing with your testimony. That's the thing with witnessing. No one can argue with it. People can maybe try and argue, you know, different theologies or different maybe beliefs. But one thing that no one can argue is your testimony. No one can argue what God has done in your life. No one can argue with me the fact that I've seen someone prayed for and their leg grew 6 inches. No one can argue with me that one of my best friends in high school, his mom had MS and was in a wheelchair, couldn't walk for 15 years. One day she got wheeled down to the altar, she got prayed for, and she stood up and walked. Hasn't been in a wheelchair since. No one can argue with me about that. No one can argue with me that my grandpa was full of cancer, had a tumor in his stomach the size of a basketball, was given 1 month to live. He went back to the doctor a month later, no cancer in his body. You can't argue with that. You can try and argue with me about different beliefs. You can try and argue with me about what this scripture says. You can try and argue about this or that, but you can't argue with me about that. That's the power of your testimony. People are listening now. Tell them how God changed your life. They can't argue with that. So you start with that and you say, that shows the power of the gospel and the truth of what I'm speaking to you. Listen, because that happened, that proves that what I'm saying is true. Super interesting. And I can go all in about that, because Jesus talks about that all the time throughout the Bible. But I can be here all night talking about that. The fourth, start where people are at spiritually. Start where people are at spiritually. Now listen, this is very interesting. If you see, with the Jewish people, Paul goes to the synagogue, it says. And if you guys don't know the synagogue, that would be like a Jewish church. So he starts where they're at spiritually. And with the Greeks, it says that Paul goes to the marketplace because that's where the philosophers are. You know, there's musicians and there's cooks and there's, you know, whatever else. Marketplace is just a common place. He's meeting people where they're at spiritually. And we see that in verse 19. It says, then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus. I think that's how you say it. Say Areopagus. Where they said to him, may we know what this new teaching is that you're presenting. You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we would like to know what they mean. All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there and spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. So they invite Paul to the Areopagus, and what the Areopagus is, it's not really a building, it's more of like an institution. It was basically the Athenian Supreme Court. It had like 30 guys in it, and they would determine like murder cases and whether or not someone was blaspheming against like their gods or not, their pagan gods. You know, they'd listen to philosophy and judge its value. So Paul's there, and he's like, listen, I want to explain this to you. And he starts where they're at spiritually. And what I mean by that is, what's interesting is when Paul walks into this Areopagus, he doesn't walk in there and just start like shouting them down. He doesn't walk in there and be like, hey guys, what's up with all these like demonic gods and stuff? He's not like, hey guys, like you guys are doing this and this and this and this and this wrong and you're all going to hell. And he doesn't just go in there and start shouting them down. He meets them where they're at. You know, the reality is, you're going to draw more flies with honey, not vinegar. You're not going to help people by insulting them. You're not going to win the world over by being nasty and abrasive. So many people get that wrong. Paul starts with where they're at. You know, and there's two sides to this. Does it bother him that there are pagan gods? Yes. I'm not saying that we should just be okay with the horrible things of culture. You know, you guys know what I'm talking about. I'm not going to go into every single issue. I'm not saying that you should just be okay with a bunch of evil that's going on in the world. But at the same time, like I said, you're not going to win people over by insulting them and being rude. We see in verse 16, it says, while Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So clearly, like, it was really affecting Paul, and he wasn't okay with it. But watch how he approaches it. So it says that Paul's walking here, and it says that he sees an altar, and it's marked to the unknown God. I think that's super interesting. And here's what Paul says to that. So, and just like a little bit of backstory. So he would have been walking through this Areopagus, and he would have seen like all of these statues to all of their pagan gods. You know, it'd be like Dingleberry, Lord of Poop, or whatever. I mean, I don't know Athenian gods. But he would be seeing all these things, and then he noticed a statue, and it said, to the unknown God. And I can give more backstory, but I don't want to get too much into it. But this is what Paul says. Watch how cool this is. It says in verse 22, Paul then stood up at the meeting of the Areopagus and then said, people of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. So he starts with where they're at, and he's saying, you know, you're saying it's an unknown God. Let me just tell you about the God that you don't know, but you're going to want to know because he's an amazing God. And he starts telling them about what God's like. And I've got six little subpoints that we're just going to fly through right here. The first thing that he says to them, he lets them know, he made the world. We see in verse 24, the God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples but built by human hands. And the second thing that he says to them is he gives breath to every living creature. Now, I'm not going to take the time to read all of this scripture, but the third thing that he says is God determines and directs the nations. We see that in verse 26. You know, and then after this, he gets down to where the rubber meets the road, where he says that he says he's a good God and he cares about people. He's active in the events of life. And the fourth thing that he says is God commands all people everywhere to repent. I'll actually read this one. It says in verse 30, in the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. The fifth thing that he says, God will judge the world. And now the Bible's very clear on this. It's a part of the gospel, and it's not a part of the gospel that everyone wants to hear, that everyone needs to repent and God will judge. You know, we in our humanity, we don't want to hear that because we want to do things our way, but everyone needs to know it. There is a heaven, there is a hell. Not all roads lead to heaven. And it's true what the Bible says. And then the sixth thing that Paul says, I'm going to invite the worship team on up. He says, the name of the judge is Jesus. We see in verse 31, if we can get it up on the screen, it says, for he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. So he starts off by meeting them where they're at spiritually. He finds common ground, and then he just lays it out for them. He just lays out the basic facts. He presents the simple gospel. He didn't do anything crazy. He wasn't extremely articulate with his words. He just laid it out there for him. He just gave him the basic facts. And maybe you're asking why, you know, why didn't he say more? You know, why didn't he talk about this? And I'd say the reason why is because just in presenting the basic aspects of the gospel, there's an inherent power that's there. And if we continue on reading, listen, there was tons and tons of people who got saved because of this. And if anything, I think that's encouraging to us because it has nothing to do with you, with how smart you are. It has nothing to do with how capable you are in your flesh. It has nothing to do with you saying, you know, the perfect words in a situation. Listen, the power doesn't come from you. The power is in the simple story of the gospel. It's up to God and, you know, the Holy Spirit stirring their heart and leading them to repentance, changing their life. And now I'm going to invite you guys to stand on up. Now, I know it can be really easy to sit there and have this thought. And I know because I've had this so many times. Sit there and you're like, okay, like I hear what you're saying, Pastor Peyton. Like that, cool, that's great. You know, it's awesome that it worked for Paul. But I've tried it before. You know, I've tried telling someone about Jesus and they didn't listen. You know, they seemed disinterested. Or maybe they got upset. Or maybe I tried sharing the gospel and you know, people at school didn't think I was cool anymore. Or, you know, I got excluded from this friend group. You know, I lost followers on social media. Whatever it is, you name it. And, or maybe that hasn't happened, but you're sitting there, you're like, man, I've never tried that before, but man, what if it doesn't work? What if they don't listen? What if this happens? The sixth point is leave the results to God. Listen, you're not the Lord of the harvest. I'm not the Lord of the harvest. You can't get one person to heaven on your own. You can't make that decision for them. I'm sure you guys have heard it before. I mean, obedience is our job, results, that's God's job. And listen, I know you guys have probably heard that before, but it's so true, and you just got to remind yourself of that. You know, in Thessalonica, which is where Paul came from, there was a church. In Berea, there was a church. In Corinth, there was a church. But in Athens, which is where this is happening, there's no record of there ever being a church in Athens. It says that there was believers there. There's people who believed in Jesus and accepted Jesus, but there was never a church there. And I know a lot of times it's easy to read the Bible and look at heroes of the faith like Peter and Luke and Paul and all these guys and think that they just batted 1,000. You know, you thought that they never failed. Every time that they talked to someone about Jesus, every single person got saved. Everywhere that they went, there was a church planted. But there's no record of there ever being a church planted where Paul's at. And I know it's so easy to get discouraged when you talk to someone, you talk to that friend who God's put on your heart one time. You invited them to church and they said no, and then all of a sudden you feel like a failure. You're like, man, never doing that again. I guess it's just, guess they're just not going to heaven. Or maybe you tried to start a Bible study one time and it kind of flopped and it didn't work. You're like, man, it's just not God's heart for me. Guess I'm just not supposed to be a part of starting a Bible study. That's not true, guys. Listen, the results are not up to you. All God asks us to do is be obedient. It's up to God to change someone's heart. It's up to God to, it's up to the Holy Spirit to convict people. Listen, conviction is not our job, even though so many Christians think that it is and they try. Conviction is not our job. I'm not saying we're not supposed to call out people in the right way with love, but conviction is supposed to come from the Holy Spirit, and you can't change someone's heart. Listen, our job is simply to join in with the Holy Spirit and talk to people about God. And then just leave the rest in God's hands. Now, tonight, we're not going to do anything super crazy. I'm not going to ask you to write down something on a piece of paper. I'm not going to ask you to go and find someone in the room and confess your sins to them or anything like that. I'm just going to ask you guys, as we're entering into this last song, what we're singing about is declaring the name of Jesus, speaking Jesus over your family, speaking Jesus over your schools, over your community, over our country. All these people who so desperately need Jesus. And as we're in this time of worship and prayer, I'm just going to encourage you to ask God to put people on your heart who you're supposed to share the gospel with, who you're supposed to witness to, who you're supposed to go and tell about Jesus, who you're supposed to go and tell about what God's done in your life. Remember, there's no one that can argue that. And as we just saw, you don't even need to say anything crazy. You don't need to write out this big speech and rehearse it over and over and over again. Listen, it's a simple gospel, but it's effective. And there's power in sharing the gospel. And I promise you, if we as a youth group unite behind this idea of dying to ourselves and in this, out of the darkness, out of the darkness of your school and the darkness of maybe your family, the darkness of your community, if we commit to being a shining light in that, we are going to turn our world upside down. And let me just encourage you guys, I get texts and phone calls from people all the time talking about how incredible it is that the things that you guys are doing, the way that you guys are sharing your faith, you know, the things that you guys are doing. I get, and I'm not even saying this to like gloat or anything, but there are people from all over the state who are like, man, New Hope Youth, you guys are killing it. You guys are making a difference. Man, we hear about you up in Rockford. We hear about you over in Moline. We hear about you on the other side of St. Louis. But there's so much more that God wants to do. God wants us to turn our world upside down. And the question is, are you going to commit to that? Are you going to commit to sharing your faith with your friends? Sharing your faith maybe with your parents or your siblings? Are you just going to be okay with them living in darkness, living without hope, living a life where they're destined for hell? I mean, that's the reality, guys. That's a part of the gospel. Not all roads lead to heaven. There's a heaven and there's a hell. God doesn't want to send anyone to hell, but people choose to go there by not accepting Jesus. But it's up to us to tell them. So